Students, today we will start a new topic, Meiji period, a Meiji restoration from the chapter part 2 modernization. So here we will see the political system of the Meiji period, who ruled from 1868 to 1912 common era. So here you can see with the Meiji restorations, the dual system of the government of the shogunate's period or the military rule or dictatorship, it came to an end, and the emperor who was the nominal head during that time, the emperor here emerged as a important figure. So in the middle of the 19th century, the US government, they sent a fleet of ship to Japan under the command of Commodore Perry. He made a commercial treaty with the government of Japan. So the treaty paved the way for signing of such treaties by Japan with Holland, Russia, Britain and France. So it gave rise to the spread of anti-foreign sentiments. So the emperor, they not provided a rallying point for the nation against the foreign threat. While the initial political settlement of January 1868 had resulted in a distinctly coalition composed of imperial prince, count noble, daimyo and their agents, and the momentums of political changes and social and economic reforms that was carried far beyond the simple act of destroying the shogunates. So the aim of those who engineered restorations, their aim was to strengthening the country to meet the threat from the foreign countries. They adopted the slogan Fukoku Kyohei, Fukoku Kyohei, meaning rich country, strong army, strength and strengthen in armed forces. So there was a great demand for the constitution of Japan. Okay, the work was given to a group of men. It was not framed by a popular representative assembly. The work of the constitutions was completed in the year 1889. It was granted by the emperor and officially proclaimed. The chief provisions of the constitution, you can see here, the institution of emperor was emphasized. He was the source of all authority and combined in himself all sovereignty. Laws, here you can see, law was sanctioned and ordered by him for execution. He could issue ordinances which had the force of law. As he is the head of the executive branch of the government, he was the supreme commander of the army and navy. He declared war, made peace and concluded treaties, but in many respects he reigned, did not rule. His functions were executed by the minister who were responsible to him. So the legislature was called the Diet. It consists of two chambers, the House of Peers and the House of Representatives. So the Diet was very powerful. No law could be passed and no new taxes could be imposed without the consent of the Diet. The annual budget was to be approved by it. So there was also a Privy Council. It was a distinct body appointed by the emperor. It gave personal advice to him. It was made up of distinguished statesmen of the land. Cabinet ministers were its ex officio members. So the Meiji government, okay, they immediately started a large number of economic reforms in the country. So the regime was one of the economic liberalism with freedoms of movement. enterprise, occupations and industry. The government pledged itself, the national affair will be conducted and carried on for benefit of the nation and the rulers. So Japan was thrown open to the outside world now, allowing the free intercourse and contact between Japan and the rest of the countries of the world. So here you can see some major economic reform as abolitions of feudalism, industrial development, reform in currency and banking, developments of means of transportations and communication, then industrial worker, and at last policy of the trade. So first we talk about the abolition of feudalism. The first important achievement of this Meiji rule, okay, here you can see, was the abolition of the feudal system in the country. In 1869, the chief of the four powerful clan, Satsuma, Chosu, Aizen and Tosa, they surrendered their position as territorial magnates and symbol of that offered to the emperor, the register of their land and the people. So by a remarkable act of patriotism, the other feudal lords, the chief daimyos, they surrendered, okay, here to the emperor their respective feudal rights and positions, and the lesser noble followed their example. So then in August 1871, feudalism was formally abolished by an imperial decree or law. You can see the clans were disbanded. Here feudalism was abolished and reorganized into prefectures on French pattern. The ex-daimyos and certain other leaders in the revolutions were rewarded with new titles of nobility borrowed from the European usage and with high offices and ample salaries under the new centralized government. The peasants were freed from servitude and made owners of the land they tilled and immediately subject of the empire. Clyde and Beer remarked that in the new society, after the 1871, the peasants were free to choose their own fate, to live or die, to remain on the land or sell out or go to the city. The way was opened for the dispossessions of peasantry and the creation of modern Japanese agriculture with its unique tenant-landlord relations. So now come industrial development. So you can see the advent of the West brought about the industrial revolution in Japan. The Meiji leader foresaw that Japan required a modern economy to supply the needs of new military forces and compete with foreign product at home and abroad. So the Japanese, they developed their mines, built factories, railways, dock, steam ships. They established cotton and silk mill, paper mill, chemical work and factories for producing glass and cement. Once these enterprises were founded, the government generally sold them to various favored private interests at extremely low prices. In this way, a few wealthy families, you can see here, Jebatsu, Mitsui, Mitsubishi, okay, Sumitomo and Yoda, collectively known as Zebatsu, gained stronghold on the national economy that had persisted to the present time. In order to control flow of foreign capital into the country, the industrial production was so designed that it would be capable of competing effectively with the foreign products. So according to the Latourette, the Japanese government, true to its intense nationalism, was averse to borrow more from abroad than seem essential for loans that seemed essential for loans from the foreigners might be followed by their control over their industries. So here you see reform in currency and banking. So the growth of Japanese commerce and now industry, it was followed by the reform in currency and banking system. The old feudal characters of the Japanese currencies, it was abandoned and it was completely reorganized to bring about uniformity. So paper currency and the decimal system were introduced on the American model. The establishment of the Bank of Japan, it resulted in the centralization of the banking system. So here you can see the Bank of Japan alone was authorized to issue the currency notes. And this was followed by the establishment of Yokohama's PC banks, which was mainly dealt with the foreign exchange business. So the growth of banking system promoted Japanese trade and commerce. Stock exchanges and chamber of commerce were also set up. Now, development of means of transportation and communication. So the development of industry and trade required an efficient system of means of communication and transportation. So here you can see in 1872, the first government owned railway line, it was constructed between Tokyo and Yokohama. The private companies were also given assistance to build other railways. Later, this privately owned this railway were nationalized. So telephone system was introduced in 1877. The government gave direct assistance to shipbuilding industries. Okay. Yoko Nagasaki and you can see Yokosuka became the center of the ship building. So now come industrial workers. With the growth of the industries, you can see the numbers of the people they are engaged in manufacturing increased from 7 lakh in 1870 to 40 lakhs in 1913. So most of the workers, they worked in the unit employing less than 5% and using neither machinery nor electric powers. More than half of the workers employed in modern factories were the women. Okay, here you can see women, modern factories were women. The credit for organizing the first modern strike in 1886 goes to women. After 1900, the number of the male worker, it also began to increase. It was only in the 1930 that the number of male worker began to be outnumber women. So large factories, they were employing more than hundreds worker, began to be established. So in 1909, the number of such factory was 1000. By 1920, then number jumped to 2000. By the 1930s, their number rose to 4000. But the numbers of the factory employing less than 5 employees was over 50,000. So this helped in sustaining the family centered ideology, just as nationalism was sustained by a strong patriarchal system under an emperor who was like the head of a family. So the rapid and the unregulated growth of industry and exploitation of natural resources led to the environmental destruction. So the first agitation against the industrial pollution, it was started by Tanaka Shozo. Okay. Tanaka Shozo elected to the first house of the representative. In 1897, he started the program of mass protest and 800 villagers forcing the government to take action. So now we will see the policy of the trade. Industrialization, it was not helpful to the common people. The great achievement in the field of industrialization, however, did not help the common people. Buss remarks that industrialization in Japan from the beginning was guided toward the strengthening and achieving greater glory of the state and not for the benefit of individual. While a few industrial families which combined at the top amassed a great wealth, the peasant languished in poverty. The population of the country increased from 30 millions in 1850 to 70 millions in, you can see, 1915, but goods were produced for export and not for the home market. So the business combination of Japan were quite different from those of the USA at the end of the 19th century. There was no specialized formation in a single market as in the case of the USA. Instead, in Japan, Mitsui and Mitsubishi bought under their control industrial and commercial enterprises engaged in different fields of activity. Economic growth, okay, in the year 1904 to 1920. So the Russo-Japanese War of this 1904 and 1905 had produced good economic result for Japan. The industrial productions was geared up during the war. The creditworthiness of Japan increased to such an extent that the country after country began to offer to lend capital resources to Japan. Foreign capital was employed in the industries like metal, electrical, rubber, shipbuilding. Japan foreign trade also started increasing in volume. The trade increased mainly with the Asiatic and North American countries. So here when we talk, China absorbed 90% of the Japanese cotton textile and the USA the whole of her silk exports. So gradually with her industrial progress and the production of superior quality goods, Japan became a serious competitor in the international market. So the First World War of 1914 to 1918 was a significant factor which helped in stimulating industrial production in Japan. All the Western industrialized countries preoccupied with the war were engaged in the production of war material. Taking advantage of this situation, Japan increased her industrial production and captured the market in the countries like India, East India, South America and Africa. Even the steel and the chemical industries registered a remarkable growth. The government helped the newly established industrial concern by exempting them from paying the business and income taxes. You see, by the end of the First World War, Japan, it emerged as an industrialized nation on the map of the world. So now we will see 1920-1939, a period of setback. So the upward swing in the industrial sphere, it came to an abrupt end in the 1920. There were various causes which combined to cause severe industrial setback to Japan after 1920. So in the first place, there was revival and reappearance of competition by the Western country after the end of the war. Secondly, against the slump and depression of 1920, it further adversely affect the home industry. Third, you can see devastating earthquake of 1923, it shook the economy of the Japan. Fourthly, you can see failure of a number of banks in the year 1927. The country further deteriorated the economic condition. And lastly, you can see the worldwide depression of 1929 and 32 enveloped the entire world. It also cast its gloomy shadow on Japan's economy. So the Japanese government, they made efforts to restore the growth of industries, okay, It introduced economic and financial reforms such as restoration of gold standard and the value of yuan to its pre-war parity. Then, secondly, the Industrial Rationalizations Bureau was set up in 1930. Its aim was to overhaul the industrial system by effecting rationalizations of industry. Then in the following years, you can see Japan was able to make much progress in the field of industry because of the devaluation of yuan and other measures taken by the government. Japan economy was restored to normalcy by the year 1936. Okay. Then you can see the index of the industrial production, which stood at 90 in the year 1931. It rose by 149 in the year 1939. Advance of loans to industries and suiting financial policy of the government brought the revival of the Japan industrial production, increase in exports, and virtually you can see full employment conditions.